and good evening. Today is June 17th. Right now it's 7:30, and I'm calling to order this evening's meeting of the Guilford Planning and Zoning Commission. For the benefit of those who have not participated in the Planning and Zoning Commission meeting, our procedures are as follows. The secretary will read the legal notice of the meeting as published in local newspapers. The applicant will then be invited to come forward and present the case, explaining to the commission and others present what is being requested of this property. Comments of town agencies will be read for each application if there are any. First, there'll be clarifying questions from the commissioners. Then there will be an opportunity for clarifying questions from the audience. Next, we'll ask those who want to support the application to come forward. Second, we'll ask those opposing the application to come forward. As this is a public meeting and must be recorded, it'll be necessary for speakers to identify themselves by stating their name and address before addressing the commission. The applicant will then be free to leave or remain for the balance of the public hearing and the regular meeting, during which the commission will try to reach a decision on each application. Each applicant will be notified in writing as to the decision of the commission has the right to appeal to Superior Court if desired. Decisions of this meeting are available the day after the meeting by calling the Planning and Zoning Office at 203-453-8039 after 9 a.m. Seated tonight are the following members of the Guilford Planning and Zoning Commission. We have Richard Wallace, Josh Hirschman, I'm Rich Meyer. We have Phil Johnson, and we have Tom Cost, and Frank DeAndrea. Reggie Reed is with us, and Lisa Marie Brewer is here, too, taking our notes. Shannon's running the cameras. Mr. Secretary, give it up.
Notice is hereby given that the Guilford Planning and Zoning Commission will hold a public hearing on June 17, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. at the Nathaniel B. Green Community Center, 32 Church Street, Guilford, Connecticut, Monuncotuck Room, second floor, for the following purposes. Bernard and Sandra Lombardi, 70 Reeves Avenue, Map 9, Lot 76, Zone R2, 440 SF, addition to house on a lot less than 10,000 square feet, Section 273-15G, Article 9, and 273-.99. Edwin Allberg, 350 Boston Post Road, Map 49, Lot 7, Zone R3, application for special permit for home handicraft industry, Section 273-38B, in an auxiliary building that existing garage on premises. That is an existing garage on premises. Teresa Ofredi, 10 Paddock Lane, Map 34, Lot 42, Zone R3. Convert existing screen porch to a three-season room, area 8 feet by 10, Section 273-101F. Renee Landry, 50 Harborview Road, Map 12, Lot 63, Zone R2, special permit for a 500-square-foot accessory apartment in the lower level of existing dwelling, Section 273-99. Stephen Rotolo and Lisa Gugliotti, 7 Rock Point Lane, Map 24, Lot 1, Zone R3, Coastal Area Management Site Plan and Special Permit for Addition to House in PRD, Section 273-91 and Sections 273-101F. Copies of these applications are available for inspection in the Office of Planning and Zoning Commission's Town Hall South, 50 Boston Street, Guilford, Connecticut. At this hearing, persons may attend and be heard, and written communication will be received. Dated at Guilford, Connecticut, the 17th day of June, 2015, Richard Meyer, Chairman.
Thank you, Richard. Appreciate that. All right, can I get a motion to open the public hearing on Bernard and Sandra Lombardi?
So moved. Second.
Those in favor?
Aye.
Who's here?
Thank you. My name is Bernard Lombardi. I'm an architect and resident of the town of Guilford. And my wife and I are going to move to 70 Reeves Avenue. We've owned the place for several years, and there have been several applications in front of your commission. The lot requirement is 10,000 square feet. Our lot area is 9,755 square feet. Hence, we need a special permit each time work is done on the house. When we first purchased the house, we came to your commission and was granted a special permit to move a bedroom, increase the area of the house vertically, and move the bedroom from downstairs to upstairs. The second time we came to the commission, We were approved to construct a garage next to the house, and that, that site plan is shown here, listed. You can see it. The garage was moved, was 5 feet off the house and 3 feet forward of the existing residence. The location is at the end of Rees Avenue, and here's a copy of the tax map in the upper left-hand corner of the site plan. It's, again, I said a 9,700-square-foot lot. It's the last house on the left-hand side as you drive down Rees Avenue. The requirement for a special permit is under both Article 10 and Section 273.99, which requires a statement of use under 273.99. Statement of use, a site plan, architectural plans, names and addresses of the adjacent owners, and the applicant's required to notify the adjacent owners by certified mail of the request for a special permit. I sent a letter as well as a copy of the site plan to each of the adjacent owners, and in the package that I'll give the secretary is the original, the application, a receipt for the application, the items that were given to the Planning and Zoning Commission with the application, copy of the certified mailings, and the responses. One resident did not pick up the certified mail, and I got a notice of that. There's one other that we haven't heard a thing with. All the other residents that have signed, and that package is there. What's currently proposed, as I said, the garage addition was approved, and we have since had sufficient time to change our minds, and instead would build a room that would be attached to the house and set back from the house. So as an improvement to the site plan.
We're doing good.
I'm now 14 feet from the property line instead of 11 feet. The building, the addition is back from the street. Instead of a driveway to the street in front of the garage, it's a graded and grassed. In the first application, we were removing an existing driveway that was on the south side of the house. We have since removed it as asphalt pavement and installed pervious stone pavement. So that section will remain where in the formerly approved one, it was grassed, but it's still an impervious, rather a pervious surface. The floor plan for the addition, the existing house, is shown unrendered, and the proposed room rendered whatever color it is, in the yellow, I'll say, the dull yellow, and this is rather fall over. It's a room that's 440 square feet. It's not a bedroom. It's a TV room we labeled it a media room. And the existing, or the proposed elevation is shown in that rendering. Here, the front of the house, or the west side of the house, the addition to the north of the existing house, the north elevation of the addition, the east elevation of the addition to the bottom of the plan, and then the existing south side of the house, which is untouched. We're going to re-side the house as well. It's currently 1 foot to weather cedar shakes, the large cedar shakes, and they're as old as the house, which is, we would guess, somewhere in the 1950s that it may have been built. We did add extend the roof to add a bedroom at the second floor. That was really the first time we were before your commission. That pretty much sums what the proposal is. The numbers. That you may be interested in is that, as I said, the site area is 9,755 square feet. The lot frontage required is 80, our frontage is 125. The street setback required is 15. What we provide, 22 and a half feet, and that remains at 22 and a half feet with the addition. The side yard setback, 8 feet one side, and 24 feet the other side. Those are the totals. What ends up with the addition is 11 feet on one side and over 45 feet as a sum. The rear setback required is 24, provided is 32, and it remains 32. The building coverage, 15 is maximum, and it is now at 15 with the addition. Total floor area, 30% is the maximum. The existing is 16%. After the addition will be 25%. Impervious surface coverage, there is no requirement. The existing is 11.8, and the proposed will be 15. That ends my presentation. If you have any questions,
pretty thorough. Very good. Jen, any questions? I have one question. When it was going to be a garage, there was a space for that door down into the basement to stay there, and now that's gone away. Do you need to worry about any other way of getting out of the basement, or?
It's through the addition. There's a basement in the addition, and we'll still be able to get out.
Good.
There's an interior stair to that basement as well.
Good. So is there anything else we need to worry about, or?
No.
Okay. That's it.
It was approved. This was also approved by, I just saw the notes, it was approved by the Wetlands Commission.
Oh, yes. The Wetlands approval is in the package.
I do have one question. I saw the packet. There was absolutely no response to this, one way or the other. I didn't see any letters.
From neighbors?
Neighbors.
I haven't heard from them.
We have.
Okay.
No response from you.
Good. Any other questions? Done. Any questions? Comments? Anything? All right.
Move this.
We got a letter in here.
There's one letter. This should be read into the record.
Give it up.
Oh, it's from Dennis Johnson, Director of Health, dated June 16, 2015. The applicant's proposed building addition is compatible with existing health code regulations regarding wastewater disposal and well water.
That's it.
That is it.
Tom, you want to make a motion?
Move to close this portion of the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Can I get a motion to open up, Mr. Albert? Thank you, sir.
Move.
Second.
Be straight.
Now we have a second. All those in favor of opening?
Aye.
Who do we have for Mr. Albert?
I
I'm Attorney John Dillon. I'm here on behalf of Ed Albert. The Albert family's been have antique business forever in New Haven, but more recently in Guilford since 1975 at the corner of Fair Street and Boston Post Road. They have the antique shop in the building at the corner, and they have a workshop in the white building directly behind Boston Post Road. The antiques business is changing. There's, today with the internet, auctions, online bidding, any number of ways, walk-ins are less common. So a number of antique dealers are looking for smaller space or no space. Edwin's analysis, he would want to stay in town but to move to a smaller location. So he's purchased the property on Boston Post Road, where Boston Street enters Boston Post Road across from the Shoreline Diner. It used to be called 551 Boston Street, now it's 350 Boston Post Road. He has frontage on both roads. Front building, we've already been through ZBA, we have a variance to run a limited retail antiques shop at that location. We have to come back to P&Z because he hopes to use the rear building, the garage, which is the smaller building here, for a workshop, and that would be used for repairing or restoring antiques among the handcraft industry. And that's it. We've you've got your packets. We've sent out notice to all the abutting owners, also the Shoreline Diner and the other commercial strip mall across the street. They've all come back. They've all been received. We've had some comments today. Ed's here. He can answer any questions. It's a fairly simple proposal.
Yeah. Good. Do we have any questions? Some of you always have a question.
What was the hardship that you used for your variance?
What was the hardship?
Yes. I was just wondering.
I think it related to the property. I think the consensus of the Zoning Board of Appeals is that no one would want to live in the house because of the high traffic rate, the proximity of the motels, the diner, sometimes the zoning regs simply don't fit the actual situation or things development. So the consensus was no one on the Zoning Board of Appeals would want to live in the house. They thought this might be the highest and best use. Very unusual way to attack it, but that was their decision.
Sure. That makes sense. Richard, anything? Mm-hmm. Good question.
Was this previously a variance?
Oh, I didn't have it in my.
Was it previously a residential building?
Yes, it was. There had been a fire there some time ago. It was residential.
Just like the entrance being met here.
I'm trying to visualize it. I'm sorry. I can't picture where it is.
Top of the hill, crossing the water tower. Yeah, right at the fork.
Oh, I know where.
Tower hotels in the back.
Yeah.
That's true.
No one would want to live there?
Well, I think anyone, if you had children.
Yeah, and go play in traffic.
No.
Well, good.
And there's a letter. I'll read it quickly. Dennis Johnson, June 16th.
Yeah.
The applicant's proposed special permit use is compatible with the wastewater facilities currently existing on site. That's it.
Yeah, he's short and right to the point. Anything else?
Not in this.
Any questions from the audience? Oh, yes.
I'm Karen Flatley at 21 Village Victoria. I'm just curious about the parking. Where would the parking? Pardon me?
For the antique shop.
For the craft store, antique shop, whatever.
The driveway. The driveway enters. I don't know if you can see this. The driveway enters here, right? And then there's a fork that goes off to another. But the entrance is in the rear, and there is space up here for parking. Again, we're not anticipating a lot of parking. It'll be Edwin's car. How many visitors do you anticipate in the course of a week?
Yeah, it's very low volume, maybe one or two customers a day.
It's not a high traffic retail operation.
Reggie, are they required a certain amount of spots to have available?
No, not for this type of business. But he does have adequate parking. He's got a long driveway, and he does have a parking area in the back. He has sufficient land. He finds that he needs more parking spaces. He can create them. And he's probably backs up to the Tower Hotel property, which is, as you know, in the TS2 zone. Or TS zone, yeah.
Good. Any other questions? No? All right. Comments, anything? No? Make a motion, Tom?
Move that we close this portion of the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor? Aye. Make a motion to open up Cerisa Freddy.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much, sir. Cerisa Freddy. There you go. Mr. Freddy.
Come forward.
Yeah, come on down. You'll enjoy it.
I'm out at the school here. First of the sixth grade was this was a schoolhouse when I grew up in this little town, 2,000 people. Just let the purpose straight. We now live at 10 Paddock Lane, which we purchased 3.5 years ago. And the porch is an 8x10 porch attached to the house, original construction. The porch was of fair construction, but in the summertime, it faces the southwest. It heats up to about 125 degrees. And in the wintertime, you freeze. So we want to make an improvement by, it's all glass, but we're going to put double glass, and each panel, which there are six, will be able to slide open and full screen two-thirds of the way down so that we can bring in fresh air and cool air, and that will solve our problem for a three-season porch. Right now, we're not enjoying it at all. I purchased the condo 3.5 years ago and did a great deal of remodeling inside. And it's our home now. It's my fourth house in this community, Guilford, in 84 years. So if you have any questions, please advise.
Questions?
Not changing the footprint of the building?
No.
So why is this even here?
Because it's Rollwood PRD. That's why. Yeah. And whenever there's a change
on the PRD, you got to come before.
When there's a change,
you'll
have to
forget. Yep. Okay. Sounds crazy, but it's true. I actually saw pictures of the school that was here, so I can identify. Do we have any questions for this gentleman? Comments?
Got a letter.
Good. Any letters from Dennis Johnson?
Yes, there is one.
Oh. There's
your pad.
Give it up.
It's dated June 16th from Dennis Johnson. Subject, Thomas O'Freddy, 10 Paddock Lane, map 34, lot 42. The applicant's proposed screen porch conversion is compatible with wastewater facilities currently existing on site.
These windows.
I know. Okay. No extra septic needed.
Anything else? Nothing? Okay.
Tom? Will we close this portion of the public hearing?
Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Mr. O'Freddy. Can I get a motion to open up Mindry?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Well, this says it's got a request for a 60-day extension.
Oh, I didn't see that. Yeah. Thank goodness. Can I get a motion to extend it 60 days? Do we need to do
yes.
that?
Yes.
Yeah. So who wants to?
I'll make a motion.
You want me to make that motion?
Second.
There you go. All those in favor?
Aye.
Nice.
We'll close this portion of the public hearing.
Thank you, sir. Does anyone want to second him?
I'll second him.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. This is rolling fast now. Mr. Rotolo and Ms. Gugliotti, I also want to open that.
So move.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Here we go. Moving at lightning speed tonight.
Anybody here?
Nobody here?
Yes, the applicant is here.
Oh, okay.
They're
huddling. Need some chocolate.
We just moved.
Number four is asking for an extension.
Sorry.
Fortunately, I had the foresight of preparing five packets that present the same illustrations that I'll hand out.
Thank you, sir.
Share.
Thank you.
Can enter this for the record at the end of my presentation. For the record, my name is Philip Campos. I'm an architect in Brantford, and I represent my client, Steve Rutolo and Lisa Gugliardi. And the application that we submitted for today's hearing is to show our compliance with the Coastal Area Management Act for the construction of an addition in order to meet the FEMA requirements. The existing building is in a planned design, planned residential development, and in fact, this actual structure was there before the development started. It was built in the late 60s. It was absorbed into the initial development in 1977 and enlarged in 1989. And it's non-conforming. The main floor of the house is at elevation 10.5, and the current FEMA map shows a base flood elevation of 12. The state statute changed in February 2014, requiring now any new compliant construction to be at least a foot above the base flood area. So the lowest level we could be legally is at elevation 13, which is essentially 2.5 feet above where we are now. And this is an upside down house. I don't know if the board is familiar with that. Essentially, the living spaces are above the other spaces. And so because of that situation, the best answer for us was to decommission the first floor, essentially, which is already two-thirds occupied by garages and has a laundry exercise area, a dent, and some mechanical space. And so our plan is to remove all the living space legally from the first floor and to put a small addition on the second floor to live essentially one story above. And that makes us comply at a small cost. The only thing we need to do is provide an entrance to the building, because now the whole house is going to be a story above. And so what we're doing, and you can see on the first page of that little yellow box on south side of the building, that will provide a front door, hood closet, a stairway, and basically a foyer to come into the house and up to the second floor. And that's new construction, and so it will be built to comply with FEMA and the new statutes at elevation 13. The shape of the building is such that by demolishing some existing space on the second floor and using an attic to put in, to move a bedroom into a space above the existing house, we'll be able to transform the whole second floor into a complete house without needing the first floor. So essentially, we end up just adding about 324 square feet of living space on the building, plus about 47 square feet on the first floor. In fact, the area we're doing is more than 47 square feet, but we're removing another area, so we're trading areas on the first floor to minimize the impact. And if you go on page 2 of the packet that I handed you, it illustrates how this works. This is a section that goes from that little yellow addition across the building toward the marsh. And if you look at it, you can see the stairway, you can see the entrance, you can see the stairway, you can see the second floor construction and the abandoned space on the first floor and a new deck. The new deck is a swap area. The square foot for square foot are identical to the area that is now, but we're just relocating it so we have more room for the addition. And if you move to the next two pages, these are two illustrations of what the building would look like when it's done. The first illustration is the entrance side, and you can see that little gable structure in between the two wings is the new entrance. And you can see a dormer in that attic attic area, we turn it into a bedroom. You know, the other side, on the last page, you see the other side of the building where the addition is actually taking place. And you can see a second dormer for the bedroom and the addition part that we tacked onto the west side of the building. And in spite of the addition, we're still able to stay at the closest about 12 and a half feet from the edge of the CAM setback requirements, so we're not encroaching. Our building design has been done to minimize any work on the coastal resource side of the property, and because of the area available on the inland side, we have sufficient space both for staging, for storing materials during construction, for debris, and that will be all separated from the at-risk area by an erosion control fence, which is detailed on the drawing that was submitted, and also detailed by the surveyor on his drawing. And essentially, because of the minimal amount of increased area, our impact is very small. We are providing infiltration system to collect 100% of the roof water for the first inch of rain and diffusing it into the ground as required by good water management practices. So I can answer any questions from you.
Very creative way of elevating the house. It's wonderful.
Well, the solution was halfway there, so
right,
it's kind of an obvious and practical way to do it.
Yep.
So we looked at raising the building, but the cost of raising the building and the zoning issues with making the building taller. In this case, we're not changing the building height, which is a fundamental.
That's the best solution. I wouldn't have seen it, so brilliant work.
Thank you.
Questions?
Weren't even tempted when you saw the house across the street being raised?
Yes, we discussed that, in fact. We seriously considered it, but the space it would have gained was a space that was least important. It was a lot more useful to make the house more compact and more functional by living on one floor, essentially, instead of living on two floors.
Yeah.
So,
did you speak with our environmental planner at all about this, Kevin McGee?
No.
There's no letter in here from him, but it looks like there are a bunch of conditions that he probably would like us to...
There is a memo.
Oh, okay.
It's in the file.
What we did do, I forgot to mention that, if I may, is because this is a planned design residential development, the plan reviewed and submitted to every member of the association who voted and approved, and if the board would like a copy of the vote approval, it was transmitted to my client by the chair of the association. One for the record. Now everything is done by email, so it's very informal.
Nice.
There's one from Dennis.
And there's one from Kevin. Because it might start some questions, I guess. Did you receive a letter, Andrew, a letter from Kevin McGee?
No, we never received any correspondence. Okay. In fact, I called the office this morning to get a copy of the report, and we never received any.
All right, so I'll just read this to you, and then you can comment on it, I guess. The coastal site plan for Stephen Rotolo and Lisa Gugliotti, 7 Rock Point Lane, shows the proposed construction of two additions to the two existing residents. The erosion and sedimentation control measures shown on the plan are designed to protect the adjacent tidal wetlands and inland wetlands from sedimentation caused by the construction activities. The Guilford Inland Wetlands Commission at its April 4th, 2015 meeting approved with the conditions the regulated activity within the 100-foot jurisdiction review zone. In order to make sure the coastal resources are protected, I recommend the following conditions of approval. The Town of Guilford Zoning Enforcement Officer should be notified to inspect the sedimentation and erosion control measures prior to the site work. Soil stockpiles should be contained by silt fencing and or hay bales. Soil erosion and sedimentation control measures shall be maintained until vegetation is established or suitable material is installed to the satisfaction of the zoning enforcement.
Is actually pretty much stock condition.
Yeah,
I expect them to be orange fence this time.
It doesn't say anything about orange fence.
Great.
Probably want a copy of this letter at least at some point, right? Would you like a copy of this letter
yes,
at
please.
Some point?
Yes. Well, I'm sorry, I can get one from you.
Okay. Can you one tomorrow?
Okay.
Don't give
that's
them
the only one we get tonight.
Well, those are the only conditions.
Okay.
Questions? We have no issues with this.
Great. Well, you can give it to
yeah, nice. Well, this isn't from the
front.
Here, go. Look at me. This is not the original.
No questions tonight? You're very quiet. It's not like you.
It's good. This is, it's...
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's the only one.
Lisa just told me that's the only one.
You guys do
it. Sorry.
Give it back. We'll make a copy.
That's cool.
Well, okay. So again, you know, when you do it this way, rather than raising up, you're still connected to the neighborhood, which is one of the issues. When you raise the house up, you become disconnected. So this is a brilliant solution. Richard, any questions?
It's pretty straightforward. Yeah.
Questions or comments? Last chance.
There is one more letter.
Oh.
From Dennis Johnson.
Oh.
All right. This applicant's proposed house addition is compatible with septic system facilities currently existing on site.
Is that it?
Sweet.
All right.
Close this portion of the public hearing.
Second.
Those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Very nice, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
All right. It's all very exciting.
Yeah,
he's had it. He's done that. It's too much for me. I have to go. All right. Oh, that's why everybody's here.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so who wants to make a motion to open the public hearing for the three?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so the Mixed Use Conservation 3, we have a developer who has asked us to approve this. Would you like to tell us more about it? Give us insights?
Bring up the other good evening. Thank you. My name is Ron Nall of the firm Moose Consulting Engineers of Meriden, also a resident of Guilford. On June 3rd, 2015, we were before you with the initial request to create the new zone MUC3, which was largely adapted from the town's existing MUOS zoning. This new zone is to be applied to property at 350 Goose Lane that Mr. Horton owns, the former Wilbur and Payne nursery. At the meeting on June 3rd, we heard objections to some of the possible site uses that had existed in the MUOS zoning that we borrowed from. And so listening to that, we submitted a revised request to the town to modify our proposed zone as follows. We deleted the possible uses for retail stores. We deleted the possible uses for restaurants and personal service establishments. Under the standards portion of the proposed zone, we reduced the density from 6 units per acre to 4 units per acre and an adjustment to the lot shape to 100 feet. I'd like to remind everyone that we're here tonight to just request the creation of the new zone, though specifically we have the site at 350 Goose Lane in mind. We would have to be back before you to actually officially change the zoning for this property through a zone change application and then also be back for site plan approval. I guess just to summarize many more steps in the process. As far as the proposed development, just to reorient you and to pick up from where we left off on June 3rd, Goose Lane running north-south here, the self-storage facility here, residential uses to the north,
and to the east, Potter Hill Road, intersecting Goose Lane approximately there. The existing Wilbur King building here to be reused. And what we propose is to convert the use to a residential multifamily detached or attached development, such as this cottage-style layout with smaller single-family living units detached around a common area, common garden area, and featuring the pond that exists on site. We believe that this is would act as transitional from the industrial zone to the south, as I mentioned, and the R5 zoning, the single-family zoning to the north. The site is 15 acres and has been previously approved, still approved for two large office buildings. We are looking at 48 residential units, resulting in a density of less than 4 units per acre, 3.2 actually, of empty nesters and young adults in a medium price range option for housing. In summary, we believe that this will be good for the neighborhood, not ever having to worry about future industrial uses occupying this land, such as what is currently allowed under the current industrial zone, manufacturing, printing, retail building materials, machine shop, contractor's yard, and warehousing, among others. We followed the design setbacks of the adjacent residential zone, actually increasing the street setback from the street line to fit in the neighborhood. If approved with this new zoning district, we'll be back before you, as I mentioned, to request the actual zone change for 350 Goose Lane. And the only other piece of information, a blow-up of the town's zoning map, just to orient you. The Goose Lane property kind of creates the northernmost boundary of the current I-2 zone, surrounded by the R-5 zone to the north and east as well. So we believe that it's transitional to go from the residential zone to the industrial zone to the south. Any questions?
I have a question. So you want the zone to say it's okay to have buildings 150 feet high?
No, the lot shape.
Oh, so how high is that? 50 feet high?
No. You mean just, that's the current zoning allowance for industrial. Is this under the MUOS?
Yeah, Section J. That's a 5-story building. You have no intentions of a 5-story building.
No.
Yeah. So,
as I mentioned, this is the zoning from that MUOS standard adapted for this purpose.
Okay. So you're not that invested in the words skilled nursing facilities, hospitals, and urgent care facilities?
No, we intend it to be the multifamily residential.
Right. I'm just trying to narrow it down a little bit. Research laboratories, you're not invested in that, you know, in that.
So well, those are still in there.
Right, but we could take them out.
One thing we should look at, too, is you're deleting number 10, clinics, medical, and dental. I don't know if it's our own error, but number 5 is the exact same thing.
Yeah, so that's why it was removed from number 10.
Because you have it in number 5?
Duplication, correct.
Would you be opposed to removing number 5 as well?
I'd say no, but it's not an offensive use in this zone. So our intention is to create residential, but as I mentioned, this MUOS is a zone that the town's already adapted, and we're just borrowing from the language of that. We removed the age 55 restriction from the MUOS. We believe removing the retail and restaurant purposes shows good faith efforts, but we don't want to further limit ourselves, I guess. Every intention is to create this, this multifamily residential development.
So what commercial activities do you foresee?
None.
Okay. But it's listed that you can do it. But you don't
right.
You mean nursing home?
Just whatever's listed.
Lodging facilities and conference centers. I guess my concern is that if we say yes here and create this district, there's going to be a lot of other folks that might be interested in other things that we're okaying by creating this, whereas you're only interested in the residential aspect of this.
Well, we would still, if you recall, we would still have to be back before you to get this rezoned, and then we'd have to be back before you to get something like a nursing home approved here. So this is...
Yeah, but then we wouldn't be able to say no to a nursing home if we approve it in a zone change unless there's some exceptional reason why we would say no.
It's a balance. Right now, industrial is a zone industrial. Right yes. Here, there'd be a metal stamping machine shop.
Sure. But if you're asking us to sort of, you know, do all this, allow you to have all these commercial uses here, and you're telling us now that you have no interest in really having commercial activity going on there, but why, you know, you don't want to foreclose that opportunity in case stuff doesn't work out for you. What's the difference between us granting you residential use and all your acreage requirements that you want to have and density, you know, changes, but not permitting the commercial requirements that you're requesting right now, and then you come back in a year if it's not working out for you and ask for commercial stuff? Because there wouldn't be really any difference unless you're really just trying to market the property to sell for commercial, you know, to sell somewhere else, flip it. But
no. We've been out to do soil tests. We're fully invested in the residential concept. It's just balancing between the broad industrial uses that are allowed today and not wanting to have such narrow limit in case the residential market should fall through.
What's your price point about going to be?
In the mid-400s or less to be higher.
And how far away are you from Route 1?
Let's see, this is launch was 500. So I'm going to say it's about 2,000 feet.
Guilford, I don't know if you're aware how Guilford's actively looking for moderate income housing development areas, and there's currently actually a commission that's looking into sites like this where, you know, I don't know if you've been approached by George Crawl at all regarding this, but it's commendable and something that the town, I think, needs. But right now we're concerned about the commercial aspects of it. And with that said, though, if you want to focus on the residential side of it, I know that there are a lot of incentives for some form of lower-level income.
This is not going to be that, because that is, they have to cap created in the deed that this affordable housing.
I'm not talking about what they're putting in the deed right now. I'm just talking about incentives that the town is looking into. We're just looking at sites, actually. The town as a whole is looking at a bunch of sites.
So the commission and the newspaper.
Yeah, so.
I mean, the biggest things that were addressed last meeting, they've taken out. Which was concerned from some of the neighbors. One person was questioning what a personal service establishment was. That's gone. The restaurants, they were wondering what could go up there, gone. Any retail use, which would probably bring your heaviest volume, is gone. Ultimately, stuff that could go there, if it residential does become cyclical and it dies down, it wants to put something, shouldn't be any different, or actually be from what's approved there now. Like he said, you can do a metal stamping factory there, which would be a lot worse than the nursing home. And a lot more.
Right, but we're creating this district, and other places will latch onto it and say that they want that too. And those areas are not under that kind of pressure.
But this, to my way of thinking, basically it sounds like what we're saying, we're going to take what is there's very limited industrial property in this town as it is, and somehow we're going to work this around, so we're going to take a chunk of property that is now zoned industrial and turn it into residential.
That's true.
And I don't think that we should be doing that.
And the reason is we need to make it
because the town still needs the property for industrial uses.
So are you saying, Tom, that don't approve this for residential use?
Well, no, but what I'm saying is I would be in favor of a mixed use, but what I hear you trying to do is take everything that's was part of the other zone and rip it out of here. So what you do end up with is just another residential development. And I don't necessarily think I agree that that's a good idea. I mean, there was a study done a few years ago, and they were talking about what is smart growth, and part of smart growth was having more condensed residential zones that are more condensed, leaving more open space, but having that condensed residential zone, having some commercial business in it, so that people won't have to go from there to go someplace else to get something they need.
So, I think I know what you're getting at. So, would that be a nursing home?
Well,
it could be a dentist office.
It could be a dentist office.
Well, a dentist office, I can support that. A nursing home, I'm kind of on the fence for. Offices, business,
is there something wrong with Westlake Lodge?
Guilford House?
One of the issues surrounding a nursing home in an area with a wetland is that their septic waste or sewage outflow contains germicides which impact the wetlands.
So then maybe they wouldn't be, even if someone wanted to put a convalescent home there and they went through the environmental process and went through that, they may not be able to do it anyway.
So you're supporting the nursing homes?
I'm not necessarily supporting anything. What I'm opposed to is yanking every possibility for this property that's in an industrial zone away from that and turning it into a residential zone.
Okay. Well, that sounds fair. How do you feel about private schools, colleges, and universities? Is that...
If it's in the other zone, because these are taking right out of the other MU zone. I don't have a problem with it. If someone says to me they don't understand the definition of personal services, and I agree 100% with that, if unless it's defined further, I think that should be taken out.
Because I tried to remove the possibly offensive uses from that previously, and that's what our revised application reflects.
Frank, what do you think? Any questions?
No. I'd like to hear from some people.
We're going to do that in a minute.
I think that the move to a residential use is a better potential use than industrial. I certainly understand the expansion idea for businesses, but I think as a general statement, abutting neighbors would probably prefer residential use. I think the trick is to limit the commercial use in association with it. It's kind of an open-ended agreement.
Yeah, I think you're right. Tom's right, too.
Anything that comes on this property would have to come back in here for...
Anyhow.
And as the Planning and Zoning Commission, we have a right to say at that time...
If we give them the use right now and then they come for a special permit, the only way we can really deny a special permit is if it's, it has to be like an exceptional reason. It has to be so far against public policy that it sort of shocks the conscience for us to deny a special permit. So once we sort of approve it, we can deny it, but then we would probably lose unless we can prove. If it got appealed, we would lose unless we could prove that it's absolutely ridiculous.
But things like the nursing home with the environmental, would we not have control of that with our environmental plan? We do that for almost anything.
The truth is we really don't have control of it. Once that septic system, they have a xenon system, I think. Once that's approved, it's no longer under our control. It's under the control of the state. And one of the wetlands commissioners happens to be one of the ones who performs the test, and he tells me it's almost always out of compliance, almost always. So, the state will try to work with you to get it back into compliance, but it's no longer under our control. But I'm not dead set against it either. I'm sort of waffling right now. Rich, what do you think?
You know, going back to the debate, the conversation we're having about wetlands, septic systems, it's all hypothetical too. But besides our approval, a xenon system would be sitting before wetlands, as you well know, and things like that. I think they've done what they could for this, and taken out the offensive language, the offensive uses. I mean, I'm sure we're all going to quibble over one or two.
Yeah, we will.
Two things in here.
Well, we're still gathering information. It's still the public here.
I don't think we should call retail stores or restaurants offensive uses.
Sorry, I know. You and I should not think that way.
Especially Dunkin' Donuts. They're wonderful. We love them. We want more of them. Maybe they can put a Dunkin' Donuts over there. Right. All right, so do we have any more questions? We want to open up to the our visitors here. All right, so anyone have any questions or comments? Or
question first, comments after.
Questions, yes, ma'am.
Karen Flatley, 21 Village Victoria. I've been following this piece of land. I was at the hearings for the office buildings. There was a lot of talk, and they eventually came up with a really nice plan. But a lot of area, open area around the office building would have been really okay over there. Now we have this gentleman come by and they say they want to do residential areas. I love that idea. Residential, great. But when I hear nursing home, emergent care facility, recreation. We defeated on Goose Lane a Y that was supposed to be built not far from this area. Goose Lane is a little street. It's a little winding street. It's not lit. It's really not an area where you want to have a tremendous facility of any sort. So I look at those things and I wonder about them. And when I see 50 feet and potentially 60 feet is a six-story building, I think. You know, that to me sounds like a city. And I don't know if there anywhere in Guilford if there is anything that big.
Thank you. Are you down to 50 feet? Are you still 60 feet? Or
I'm looking myself. We have no intention of building 50 feet.
So if we put the limit down to 35 feet, would that be in keeping with what you need? I'm speaking hypothetically.
I mean, 35 is the
building they arrived. How high? I think it's around 38.
Yeah. 35 feet is what is generally allowed in any residential zone, correct? Under the MUOS zone, I mean, we have no intention, so yes, maybe recognize that nothing higher than the existing building, something like that.
That's a two-story building.
It's got quite a roof on it.
It does have a really high peak roof.
Yeah.
Just want to address the neighbors' concerns. I know there are some areas in town where there are 70-foot limits, which is crazy, seven-story building. We have a new hook and ladder, we want to have a reason to use it. Other questions? Doctor?
Dominic Presento, 199 Bruce Lane. I have a question about the parking. Can you tell me where the guest parking for those places would be?
This is not a site plan, this is a concept. I mean, this isn't even we're not even officially talking about this property. They're creating a zone tonight. But there would be ample guest parking. It's interspersed throughout the site as well. But this wasn't intended to be a site plan for review.
Would that have to come up before review?
Mm-hmm.
The site plan for the public?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So that's when you present
that
you
could
even open the door to that.
And you're required
so
a contest. That could be completely different when they come in, 100% different.
Well, I do have concerns about the density of it because I think it does, in a sense, devalue the neighborhood because we're on one-acre zoning, and I don't know of another place in Guilford that has apartments or condos that is that dense. And someone said last time at Copper Hill is, but I actually beg to differ because they have a lot of open space, they have some trails, they have a pond.
We didn't show the, I'm sorry to interrupt, we didn't show the entire, this property, this is the front part of the property. 10 acres of this or thereabouts are undeveloped along the backside. The density here at less than 4 is about half of the density of the Foundry, about half the density of Griffin Square here in town.
Where's Griffin Square?
It's the old high school behind LAU.
But they're downtown, and this is country. This is not, that's not Bruce Lane. So,
there's, and actually, there's quite a few spots in town that have current zoning of 6 units per acre. And we reduced our request from 6 to 4. Aren't I correct? There's quite a few.
You did. And also, you know, I asked staff to come up with the, because you mentioned Copper Hill, and so, you know, really try to listen. And so, Copper Hill has 130 units on 42.21 acres. So that's
three
and change. So this is not, it's not a world of difference. It is, you know, denser. However, you brought this picture up. It's not, there are areas in town that probably have higher density. And one of the things that we're talking about, to go off on a tangent, is affordable housing, which would be much higher density. And so, you know, you're right. It is a country setting. It is going to be maybe a touch denser than what you want. But given the alternative of having, you know, I guess legally you could put a boundary there right now, this is a tremendous step up. So nothing is ever going to be perfectly what we want, but, you know, we try to look at the highest use of the land. This would lock it up from any kind of industrial development for a long time. So, you know, maybe if we're going to consider a slightly denser development, it might be okay if we consider that we're not going to have any real commercial industrial type development there, although we could. So, you know,
what was Copper Hill? 3.1?
Copper Hill is, if we're 3, it would be 126, so it's just over 3, 3.1, 3.2.
Which is this density.
Right. So, yes, sir.
Mark comes Village Victoria. I think when you're trying to lock them in with just having residential zoning, you're not going to get people to invest in Guilford when they put up so much money for this property, and then for some reason, if they fail through zoning by density, they can't make money, that you don't expect them to do anything else. I mean, leaving it open for a convalescent hospital or an office building would be fine because you can't get residential. It's still not going to be propane.
Right.
And then, in referring to the traffic problem, I walk down that road for months at a time, and every afternoon from the medical buildings, the people that work there walk up to our complex. We've never had a traffic density problem. The traffic density problem is at the exit of I-95 in Route 1, where with the $30 million transportation bill, they should be rectifying that, not the builder.
Correct. I don't disagree, sir.
So, I mean, I'm all in favor of the condos. I'm sure they are, too. They're reputable people. But in the event that it doesn't pass, I mean, you know, when the cards fall where they may.
Okay. Getting all these messages about our discussions. Zoning in this area, if it's limited to 40 feet?
If it's a 4-acre lot, as the R8 zone requires, they can go up to 40 feet in height for a house.
That's an R8, and this is going to
be... This is, well, they're talking about 4-acre zoning here. That's the minimum lot size, lot area for this new district they want to create. It's 4 acres, so I would suggest that you let them go up to 40 feet in height, because it's a big lot. And then you're consistent with some of your other zones.
Right. You okay with 40 feet? All right. Any other questions?
Yeah, Joe Flatley, 21 Village Victoria. We're missing one point here. Again, it's not going to be over 40, over 55. You're going to have kids. The kids cost money in this town. $17,000 a year.
I know. I was just having a conversation about that with another resident earlier. When I moved into town, I had two kids that were in the school system, and they were costing at the time, I don't know what it was, $15,000 a year. And they went 10 years apiece. That's $300,000 my kids cost. And I don't think I'll live long enough to pay that back to the town. Trying. And they keep raising the taxes, so I may catch up. But the truth is that we are going to have kids coming into town, and it's never going to be a fair, equitable distribution of expense. That's what towns do. We all bear the expense of all of the residents' needs. You know, I pay to support, I'm going to be paying to support a high school I'll have no kids at, and I'm glad to do it. I don't really go to Jacob's Beach that much. I pay taxes to support that. So there are going to be kids, and it may not be a profitable proposition for the town, just straight out, if you only take the kids into account. However, there are other things, you know, people who live there will participate in the town, promote businesses in the town, buy coffee in the town, Dunkin' Donuts, do things. But I hear what you're saying, and I am of mixed feelings that, you know, every town that has kids moving in is going to bear those expenses, and it's just part of the business of being a town, part of the expenses. You are right, probably going to be kids there.
You know, and every residential unit in the town is probably the same way. I don't think that any home could ever pay back for the kids' expenses of going to school. So, you know, you're right. However, I don't know that that's the one and only decisioner in this case. So I hear what you're saying. Sir?
Yeah, Mark Larkin, 1 Potter Hill Drive. I live right across the street from this piece of property. I wanted to address Tom Cost, taking a roll, you know, industrial land off the, and I understand that. But really, the industrial land stops at Carter Drive. From Carter Drive north, except for the storage units, which you can't even see, this piece of property is nestled in all around residential property. So I personally feel like this is a great, you know, change. And plus, I'm sick and tired of starting to look at an eyesore every time because the property's just not being developed. Since Wilbur came, nothing's happened to this property, and it's just deteriorating. I think, you know, along the pond, a residential zone, that's good, the rest of residential properties, fits this property very, very well.
Thank you, sir. Tom, what do you think?
What? Listen to it.
Who else would like to speak? Come on, someone's got to have some thoughts. Brian McGlone. We're going to hear from Brian.
Yeah, I am Brian McGlone. Thank you. We are focused a lot about what the zone is or what it could be, with some understanding of what they would like to do with it. Taking and scratching out a lot of the potential use. I mean, when we create a zone, it's not just for this particular pocket. It could be adopted or used somewhere else in town as well. So we have to just kind of think about all the commercial uses that are already in that zone that are allowed in the MUCOS. So they were trying to take and not be accused really of spot zoning as well, because we've been accused when we narrow it down too much. You know, it looks like spot zoning, because again, we're pointing to this particular piece of property. And I mean, and I'm actually saddened to say that they're willing to pull retail out, because what if the old Wilburton space was, whether it's a coffee shop, a breakfast spot, or a little retail spot that would service that community? Because we talk in other areas of the plan of conservation and development where we would like to have more commercial nodes and walkable neighborhoods where you can shop. So I almost hate to see that being pulled out, just as a side note. I would like to make a comment too, just about the education or the potential for kids. There's a report, a well-documented report on the school website the school did a projection. This report was issued November 25 of 2014. Given the 10-year projections of what Guilford school system looks like, and just to put a couple things in perspective, in 2004, we had approximately 3,800 students in our school system. Today, we have under 3,400, and the 10-year projection has taken it down to 2,500 students the next 10 years. The people that are projecting the next 10 did the same kind of study in 2007, and their projections from 7 to 14 were off by less than 1%. So I think it gives them some credibility that this could happen. You can read all of this, and it gets into birth rates and how many people are being born here, and how the size of families, what the economy is doing. So personally, I'd love to see something that would stimulate and bring back more kids into the school, because we, and we do, whether it's $15,000, $17,000, $14,000. I made a comment during the budget hearings, because this year there's 80 less students, or roughly a million one. And that million one didn't come out of the education budget. I mean, there's a certain amount of infrastructure, buildings, space. If you look at the classroom sizes, they're well below what they're allowed by contract. So all the schools are highly underutilized. Might we have to hire back more teachers? Might there be more supplies? Yeah, I would, but I don't think it's necessarily those incremental people coming back. So I hope we don't get too focused on that piece of it. I hope we look, and it's like a two-edged sword, because I know, and you know, this isn't a site plan and there's details to be filled in, but conceptually, this type of development, this cottage-style development, it's popular, it's grown around the country. You go out in Seattle, you go to Portland, other areas around the country, this concept of the smaller homes, smaller square footage, and you know, I don't know, Ron, if you highlighted, you know, the pond is there, there are walking trails there, so they're trying to utilize that. And again, it's not a site plan, and there's more details to come on that. So I personally would like to see a modified use. Tom, I appreciate your comments. I, for one, we are losing industrial sites. Hate to see that, because pound for pound, they're also pretty good in tax generation. On a cost per square footage basis, they're good, but I'm also looking at the demand for it, the real demand, and how many jobs. Even this property, when it was rezoned to offices 5 years ago, the developer, the people that owned it prior to this, couldn't build the offices. In today's market, the construction costs, new office space, what do we yield or generate, require the lease cost to be? Nobody could afford to move into it. So we had a good idea in the offices, but couldn't afford to build them. So I guess I'm going back to kind of the best use of the land. If we leave it industrial, hey, we'll go pursue a warehousing operation or something else. Would attract some, or go for something like that. But from an ultimate use in the town, we'd probably gain less out of the tax.
I think maybe, Mark, you misunderstood me. What I'm concerned about is yanking this. This is proposals for mixed use zone. Mm-hmm. And what I feel is we're trying to do here is yank the mix out of it, basically. By saying you can't have this, you can't have that, you can't have that. I think this is a great, I agree with this, I think it's a great plan. But I don't want to preclude the fact that there can't be some businesses intermixed with these buildings. Not that I don't think this shouldn't be done at all. I think it should be done. But don't take all the stuff that could go on that property in the MU zone out of the plan.
He doesn't want to go in just strictly residential. That's what he's saying.
I mean, for example, the building that you're talking about, the Wilbur and King building, that could be, you know, we laughed about it, but that could be a little place where there could be some small shops in there that would service that neighborhood.
Absolutely. That's why
that's what I'm talking about.
I hate to see that retail or a...
Can we put retail back?
Or a restaurant.
Is there a planned density for the commercial aspect of it? Like, is there some number of commercial units per acre?
I think if it were to go commercial, you would just be talking about some of the other standards, side use, side yard, front yard setbacks, lot covers, things like that. There's no units per acre commercial.
Yeah, I don't think he has any intention of doing commercial right now, so
this is just,
it's not like he's got like, you're not planning on having like upstairs residential downstairs commercial.
I mean, how many?
Well, you have a point. If we say, you know, it's cool to have stores, potentially they could have stores and have lots of stores. You know, they're limited to, you know, 30 houses or whatever they have. But that's residential setting. In a store, you know, we say yes to stores. You know, I guess it would come up in the site plan if you had proposed, you know, 80 stores or a shopping plaza.
We still need the parking.
I don't know how we conceptualize this being different than what we think is going to be good around in towns that are south, where you have, you may have a small deli shop and above it is an apartment. Isn't that basically the same kind of thing we're talking about here?
Sure.
We have that in Village Walk. Village Walk, almost all the second story as we come off is converted.
You know, we might have insights of Stephen Cops. He always has.
Sorry.
Maybe he'll talk to us.
Office.
Oh, I'm sorry. Apartments.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I meant apartments.
Well, I agree. And I think that, like I said, the retail, and you know, I won't be opposed to restaurants retail, but I think they're okay with it. I think we should kind of be looking at what they're proposing, and not trying to redissect it and add things in or limit it to strictly residential at this point in the phase. I think we should look at what's proposed.
I guess what I'm concerned about is someone else latching onto it who has far more aggressive plans.
Right, but the way it's proposed, it still never have a retail store, it still never have a restaurant,
yeah.
It still have a personal service establishment.
I know. Well, Brian, thank you for your comments. I appreciate your being here. Stephen, I'm sure you have something to say.
I'll keep it brief, but basically, I mean, I agree with what Brian has said and what Tom has said, and I'm glad to hear it. I get the sense is that you're not saying only residential is trying to have a limit it. I have a question for Josh. When you're saying that if it's, you know, concerned about letting the cat out of the bag versus take it out and not allowing it at all, can't you pick and choose and say some things we would allow by special permit?
That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
But if we do allow by special, if we allow it and we allow it by special permit, it's really hard to not approve a special permit. It has to rise to the level of, I have to work the statute.
The disaster, you're right.
But it doesn't mean that we won't get a lot of public input and we can lay the foundation to reject a special permit application. But I think that at this stage, I mean, if they're willing, if they don't have any interest, I think we have to look at the application, like Frank was saying, as it's presented to us. And the applicant is saying that he's only intending anything for residential use. So for us to speculate, we're trying to cut back on the stuff the applicant's willing to cut back on. We talked about the 40 feet, reducing that, and I think that really the only other hangups that we're going to have a discussion about are going to be clinics, lot, or private schools, and recreational facilities. Other than that, I mean, I think that we've reduced it down to something that people are comfortable with.
Because that's my concern, that this doesn't get reduced down too much.
Yeah, I don't see that.
Thanks, Dave.
You mean, private school could be Montessori?
Yeah. That would be daycare.
Yes, ma'am.
Karen Flatley, 21 Village Victoria. When I went to the Planning Commission, and you made your first presentation, sir, and you talked about condos, and you said mixed use, I thought, okay, we're talking about residential, and or it could be office buildings, or, you know, things that were acceptable to me. But now we're talking about commercial. And commercial is a whole different, commercial is Route 1.
What's known as commercial?
This is Goose Lane. They could conceivably have a strip over there.
No, there's no retail.
Well, but he's talking about putting it back in.
No.
Not
what was proposed.
I just think that we have to be thinking ahead. This is a small country road. There are residences all around. The fact that down near 95 are some office buildings, making it commercial would be a totally different use of that area.
So you'd rather have it industrial?
Industrial residential. If you're creating a new zone, I don't think you need to add in commercial.
But are you specifically referring to retail, right? Not necessarily...
Retail, restaurants, that sort of stuff.
Right, so he keeps that out, like his original...
You mean his original...
The original where it says no restaurants, no personal service, no retail. That's more palatable, right?
Yes, it is.
So it's the original proposal.
Yeah. Who else? It's got to be somebody.
It seems to me we've all hit all nails on the head. These folks have listened to the neighborhood. Some of this is allowed for Plan B. If we have another downturn in housing, they have other options to use for the parcel and keep it at that. I mean, they have their rights too. They own the property.
Yeah, that's you know, that is something we were all discussing. Is, you know, who makes the decisions, whether the property owner owns it and makes the decisions, or whether the town makes the decisions, or the neighbors make the decision. And, you know, the way that the state of Connecticut answers that is it makes us sit here and try to figure it out and argue. And it's pretty effective because we come up with a common ground. Who else? Someone has to say something. Not going to let you all get away with one more. Yes.
I'm all in favor of the condos. I don't care about stores, strip malls. I think that's an added plus for our neighborhood.
So you're thinking that to sort of exclude
residential, yes.
Yeah, just limited to residential.
And I think it's good for the whole town, for your shops in town, for your doctors, your lawyers, for everything.
Well, and you bring up a valid point, because if we start opening other cafes and shops over there, then that's going to take away from the other businesses in town. So you open one here and you close one there. And that's something I've seen over the last year, is we keep on opening a cafe that puts another cafe out of business, and then someone else opens up another one, puts this one out of business. So there has to be some way of establishing a value business that's not going to put other businesses in our town out of business.
We have a great little town, we have a lot of little stores, restaurants, coffee shops. Let's keep it there.
I tend to agree with you.
I noticed there was a letter. Do you want me to
read
it?
Go ahead.
It's from you. Do you think you adequately stated what you wrote to us?
Yeah, the changes.
Yes.
I believe that I had mentioned every single one.
Okay. Would you like me to read into the record?
Sure.
Okay. Dear Planning and Zoning Commission, on behalf of the property owners in Guilford, I hereby ask to amend the proposed mixed-use conservation 3 zoning district that we submitted and presented at a public hearing on June 3rd, 2015. The proposed zoning district standard changes are attached. Sincerely, Ronald Malt. And I'll read the changes so everyone sees it. We propose the following modification to the original proposed wording of the MUC3 zone district that were presented at the public hearing on June 3rd, 2015. Permitted uses. The following uses are permitted in the MUC3 districts. Delete and entry. So these are the ones being deleted. Retail store when accessory to a permitted use and located in the same building as permitted use, not to exceed 10% of the floor area of the primary permitted use. Restaurants when accessory to a permitted use and located in the same building as a permitted use, not to exceed 10% of the floor area of the primary permitted use, not to exceed 10% of the floor area of the permitted use, except when part of a lodging facility, conference center. Clinics, medical, and dental, which was just a repetition, and then personal service establishments. And then area location and bulk standards. The following area location and bulk standards apply to the MUC3 district. B, lot shape change 150 feet to 100 feet. H, maximum density of resident uses, the maximum shall not exceed, change 6 units per acre to 4 units per acre.
And that really is the hallmark of you. You always listen to the neighbors, so good for you.
Well, we can talk about, this was just a letter that I was reading into the record.
Yep, and I've already made a note of the 40-foot height in my records.
Now we can use the fire truck.
Yes, there you go. So, any other comments, questions? This is your one moment to shine and speak. We want you to do it.
Gina Freddy, I'm a native of this town. And I think in keeping with the town the way we know it, I think that a property presentation would be ideal for condos. You have a great number of people looking for a place to live in Guilford. And we have a graying America in Guilford and elsewhere. And this might just be the right opportunity to develop that site into that kind of a situation. But having mixed commercial, I don't think it's going to go. That's my opinion.
Good. Well, thank you for expressing it. So who else? Yes?
Could you just define again, because I'm now very confused about what this could be if this gentleman decides he doesn't want to do this.
Well, we're sort of rushing that out.
I could read to you the permitted uses in the MUC3 district.
But with
without his.
Without the things
yes.
that he's now deleted. Yeah.
All right. Number one, dwelling units, housing that is designated and intended to be of a community pattern. This use may include multifamily units and detached cluster or attached single-family units. The use may also include assisted living facilities, congregated living, and nursing homes. Two, recreational facilities other than of the town, including outdoor common structures. Three, lodging facilities, including conference centers. Four, private schools, colleges, and universities, including daycare. Five, clinics, medical, and dental.
Structure.
No, we just, he, it was just.
Oh, structure. Yeah. Five.
Okay, six, office, business, and professional. Seven, financial institutions. 12, research laboratories, 13, building uses and facilities of the town, state, and government, 14, skilled nursing facilities, hospitals, urgent medical care facilities, 15, places of worship by special permit in accordance with 273-118, 16, artists, studio galleries, and other establishments where art or craft merchandise is created, displayed, and sold, 17, museums by special permit in accordance with 273-18, 18, farms. Those would be the uses that would be permitted with this mixed commercial application.
So, who's got something else to add? Anything? Every opportunity. Sir?
I might as well go up and say something. I'm Doug Stokely, and I live in Village Victoria. I think that the people that have made the presentation here tonight has demonstrated good faith in that what their intentions are, and they've relieved a lot of concerns with making adjustments. And no doubt in my mind that if this thing goes residential, it's a win-win for everybody. But being a businessman, you have to have options. And as Mark had pointed out earlier, if there's a severe downturn in residential and this thing doesn't get booked out, our community, Village Victoria, went through the same thing. It started out very robust early, and there was a big crash in 87, 88 in the condo market. Things like that could happen again today, and we all aware of that. These people have to have some sort of fallback as to the best use of of their investment and their property. And I think what we've talked through here tonight is some options for them, and it gives us, I think, the best bet going forward. It is, that it will be a success as a residential community.
Good. Well, thank you. Good. This is great. Everyone's talking. So any last minute comments, because we're going to close the public hearing, then we're going to sort of hash it out amongst ourselves when it comes up again. And if there's anything you want us to know or think about, this would be the time to say it, because we're going to be talking and dealing with all these things.
And just to point out, I know where Tom's coming from. You know, if we eliminate all the commercial, all the industrial, all we're going to have is residential. So Tom is talking in a broad way, saying, you know, here's some more industrial that's going away and becoming residential. And, you know, part of the problem with that, and we saw that in some consideration of some possibilities not in the last couple of months, part of the problem is that we've grown up around these industrial areas. You know, what used to be isolated industrial areas are now, you have residences right on top of them. And so we struggle to try and figure out what to do, but I understand exactly what you're saying. So any other things you want to add? Last chance. Any other thing? We're done. Any other comments?
We'll close this portion of the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Good. Perfecto. 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 All right. So back to the business. Okay. Can I get a motion to approve the revised agenda?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Deliberation of public hearing items. Can I get a motion to table? To table. We're going to come with Lifestyle until September 2nd.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Mr. Vito has withdrawn, so I don't have to do anything with that.
Red Rooster.
The Red Rooster Baking Company. Can I get a motion to set a public hearing date on July 15th for the Red Rooster?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Wait. There's something more in here.
Yes, we should. Deliberation of public hearing items, and then we went right into...
Yeah, there's no deliberation. Oh, okay.
We got five things to do here.
Okay, so let's do it. Let's just do it. Let's open up with Lombardi.
Okay. I'll make a motion for them to open it.
Okay.
Discussions. Voted that the Guilford Planning and Zoning Commission approve a special permit for Bernard and Sandra Lombardi to add a 440 square foot addition to a house on a lot less than 10,000 square feet at 70 Reeves Avenue as shown on residential addition 70 Reeves Avenue, Guilford, Connecticut, 85215 sheets A.1.1 through A.14. Residential addition 70 Reeves Avenue, Guilford, Connecticut, site development plan dated 5/2/15, sheet L-1. The above prepared by Bernard J. Lombardi, architect and planner, plot plan number 70 Avenue, property Reeves. Of Madeline Comezzo, Guilford, Connecticut, dated 10/19/06, prepared by Woodworth Associate PC, surveyors and planners. This application is approved with the following conditions: that prior to any site disturbance, the zoning enforcement officer inspect erosion controls. This application is approved based upon a finding that it conforms with section 273-15G of the zoning code. The special permit is effective on June 26, 2015, and upon filing with the town clerk.
Second.
All right. So Mr. Lombardi has made a wonderful presentation.
Did we tell him about the prior to any site disturbance, the zoning enforcement officer inspect erosion controls?
That was
a condition.
Kevin,
yeah.
That wasn't read in either.
It wasn't read in. There was no letter from Kevin McGee read into the record. Because we didn't have it in the packet. I'm just concerned that he has no idea that we're going to give him this condition.
I think Mr. Lombardi knows this better than
me. Yeah, I'm sure.
Doesn't have to come from Kevin. It is
coming from us.
Well, would you like me to read it into the record?
Well, there's not really a public record now.
That doesn't mean the public hearing is closed.
It's just, I'm sure that he does, and I'm sure this is just normal.
Yeah, I'm sure Mr. Lombardi, as a professional, would not be at all surprised that he has to tell these people.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that would not be a problem for Mr. Lombardi.
No, it isn't. I just feel bad that right. We can tell him.
I apologize, Mr. Lombardi.
June 11th.
As professional as you. All right, so let's discuss. I've been out to the house a couple times now. And this is really, you know, an improvement over the garage on that side because it just flows better. You don't have to change the land. It's further away from the property line. It looks beautiful. Mr. Lombardi blows us away with all the information he gives us, so I'm sure he's well equipped to do this. What do you think, Tom?
I think we should vote yes.
Right. Same. He's decreasing the non-pervious surface, which is great. Eliminating a curb cut.
Okay. Hang on, we have a...
I need you to talk louder.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Okay, so we'll all turn it up a little bit so that we can all hear. That's great. Thank you.
All right.
Richard?
Bernie has come back and it's soup to nuts, A to Z. Dot the I's and cross the T's.
But, you know, absent of objection.
We gave him every opportunity. All right, so let's call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Mr. Lombardi, thank you.
Congratulations.
You make us look like amateurs, so thank you for being so good at what you do. Can I get a motion for Mr. Alberg?
All right. Forward that the Guilford Planning and Zoning Commission approve a special permit for Edwin C. Alberg III for a home and craft industry in an auxiliary building at 350 Boston Post Road, FKA 551 Boston Street, as shown on property survey of C. Alberg III, 551 Boston Street, Guilford, Connecticut, dated December 22, 2014, prepared by Anderson Engineering and Surveying Associates. This application is approved based upon a finding that it conforms with Section 273-38B4 of the Zoning Code. The special permit is effective on June 26, 2015, and upon filing with the town clerk.
Second. Got a second. All right. So, any concerns about the parking that was brought up, or we feel confident there's plenty? Frank, what do you think?
I think we should vote yes.
Tough intersection, but
yeah. No, he wants to do it. I think the only thing he's really going to have is the UPS truck once or twice a day. I mean, it's not really customers aren't going to be calling in there. So.
And it is a very commercialized area.
Yeah, right. So I think it's great.
They got the hardship, so it must be commercialized.
Right, it must be, exactly. No one else does it. All right, so all those in favor?
Aye.
Congratulations. Thank you for staying in town. We appreciate it. Teresa Offredi.
Voted that the Guilford Planning and Zoning Commission approve a special permit for Teresa G. Offredi for a change in approved PRD to convert an existing screen porch to a three-season room as shown on an aerial photo dated and received on May 5th, 2015 of 10 Paddock Lane. This application is approved based on a finding that it conforms with Section 273-101F of the Zoning Code. The special permit is effective on June 26, 2015 and upon filing with the town clerk.
Second.
All right, so Mr. Offredi has told us that he can't use his porch. We'd like him to use his porch. I'd like to use his porch too, but he won't. Any other thoughts about this?
My only comment is I just, like Tom said, I'm sorry that he had to come here for this, and I understand he had to, but I think that's such a waste of his time.
Is there any way that, is this something that can be handled by the staff going forward?
Brian wants to. Actually, Brian's going to handle it from now on.
I don't know.
We can change the zoning regulations.
Well, I just don't understand.
Another time.
Not today. I just, you know, I know we talk about making our commission more efficient and better serving the town. So
right.
This could be added to a list of things to discuss under the zoning.
Right. You could put it under exemptions.
Right. Yeah. So in this case, it makes perfect sense to have them do it.
Yeah.
But the problem is, once you open the door, then you have all our friends.
No, I don't think I'm not opening any doors. I'm saying if you're changing out your screen doors, you shouldn't be required to come before planning and zoning for special permit.
Right. All right. All those in favor?
Of course.
Great.
Put it
how
on
about
schedule.
Things to do.
Things to do.
How about Renee Landry?
That was a 60-day extension.
Extension. Stephen Rotolo and Lisa Gugliotti.
I'll read this motion for Stephen Rotolo and Lisa Gugliotti. Ordered the Guilford Planning and Zoning Commission approve a coastal site plan for Stephen Rotolo and Lisa Gugliotti for a change in an approved PDR to decommission and replace living area below flood base elevation with a 2,324 square foot second floor addition built on stilts at 7 Rock Lane as shown on one an improvement location survey property of Stephen Rotolo and Lisa Gugliotti, 7 Rock Lane, Point Lane, Guilford, Connecticut, March 9, 2015, prepared by Waldo & Associates, LLC. 2, Rotolo Gugliotti Remodeling, 7 Rock Point Lane, Guilford, Connecticut, 06437. Proposed site plan dated 4-19-15, prepared by Philippe Campos,
Architect LLC. The above plans are approved with the following conditions. Prior to any site disturbance, the zoning enforcement officer inspect erosion controls. Two, soil rock stockpiles to be contained by silt fencing and staked by bale haze or staked by bale haze. Three, erosion controls shall be maintained in a manner in which they are were approved for a period of 1 year or one growing season after completion of the project. Four, prior to removal of such erosion control, sedimentation control measures, vegetation shall be established to the satisfaction of the zoning enforcement officer. This application is approved based upon a finding that it conforms with section 273-91 of the zoning code and is consistent with the coastal management policies of the state of Connecticut.
Second. Okay. So this is a really creative way of getting around lifting the house up on stilts, and looks great. It'll keep in the neighborhood. And Philippe has done an excellent job.
I just think, you know, we just added, made him aware of the conditions about the silting and the examination of the erosion control.
Yeah. Tom, any other thoughts?
No. I mean, these are pretty much, are you concerned about the fact that they're being inserted in here?
No, it's pretty much SOP.
They're pretty much SOP, so I don't think they have a problem with it. So I'm for it.
You're done with the SOP?
Yeah.
Good for you. All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Wonderful. Excellent, so that passes. Are there any abstentions or no's? Or, anyway, just banging them out tonight. All right, so that brings us to...
Mixed use,
so...
I'll go ahead and try.
Go ahead.
All right, proposed motion. Voted that the Guilford Planning and Zoning Commission approve an amendment to the zoning code to create a new zoning district, mixed use conservation 3. As heard at a public hearing on June 3rd, 2015 and June 17th, 2015. With the following changes which were submitted by the applicant and read into the record earlier, and the other change to the maximum height being from 50 feet to 40 feet of a building.
I don't know if that has to go on here until that goes to site plan.
Well, we'll start with this.
So that's an item J?
That's an item J, yes.
Because the maximum building height would be 40 feet, except within 150 feet of the rear residential district boundary line, where the height shall be 35 feet.
Yes, so that would be my motion.
All right, so...
I'll second.
Thank you. So let's just make sure we're all on board with each of these, and then we'll take a vote. So the dwelling units, we don't have any questions about. The recreational buildings other than the town, including outdoor common structures, are we all okay with that?
What is an outdoor common? I don't know what
I
that
think
is.
It might be a pavilion.
Well, I think what? They have a...
Could be a pool, a pavilion.
It could be a pool. It could be an ice skating rink.
Basketball court.
Climbing wall.
But it could be for their common use also, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Doesn't necessarily have to be a business.
It could be a playground.
It could be anything.
Or a
big sandbox.
And for it.
Okay, so that's in.
Well, no, maybe not, but I'm just saying.
All right, well.
It meets that definition.
It seems to have support of everybody. Lodging facilities, including conference centers. Thoughts? I'm not feeling it. I don't want to put it in, but that's just me.
I agree with you. I don't see the point of it, but with that said, I don't see the point of restricting it.
Exactly. Until we actually change the zone for this specific right. lot. Yeah. Then
so
we're just talking hypothetically.
Hypothetically, yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Right.
And they did come to us with all these.
I mean, if they came back to us at the end to change it to a residential, would we have the option to do that?
We can do it.
We are all powerful.
I think I understand we have to talk this all the way through, but I think everybody that spoke was very happy and was content. I know they would want to see it 100% residential. We all agree, but I think everybody in that room agreed that they're okay with what's presented.
other than the retail stores, the restaurants, the personal service, which are eliminated.
So I guess someone else having some property in Guilford and saying, I want this too, potentially could put a hotel or a motel up or a conference center. Is that a risk?
It wouldn't be if we limited the density. I mean, if we actually put in some type of a...
So what kind of wording would you put?
You put, a limit of one commercial, unit per acre, or something.
So
like
one
that.
Motel per acre?
So we could do motels by special permit, and then we could have people come in and yell.
I'm just saying, how many commercial, do we want to potentially limit the number of commercial units? Or not? I mean, we all know what the plan is eventually going to be.
Okay, so
what will be.
So how about lodging facilities, including conference centers, limited to the 4 per acre, as mentioned in other parts of this?
I don't...
Too much?
I'm speaking out.
Well, speak out.
Well, he could have come here without any plan.
I'm not concerned about him. I'm saying someone else using this could use this to pry open the door to put something that maybe we don't want. That's all I'm concerned. I don't think he's going to do it.
I think that if somebody else is coming in, not even to this person, to rezone something, MU3, we'd go through this whole dance again.
Yeah. I think we should leave this alone for now.
Okay.
Is what I guess I'm saying.
All right, that's fine.
With what he said he'd already have us take out of it, I think we should leave it alone.
Okay.
Because it's still got to come back. I mean, this is just to create the zone. He's got to come back and ask to have that piece of property, this zone.
Yeah. Phil, are you okay with looking at it?
Yeah, Josh.
Yeah, I mean, the only ones that I would have a problem with are ones that I don't think are going to go there anyhow.
So private schools and colleges are okay. Clinics and medical and
well,
dental.
Well, I mean,
okay.
When I guess the problem I'm hearing you is, think about that for a second. A private school could be someone given violin lessons, and they have 2 students or 3 students a day. I mean, that's a private school. And so that's, it doesn't mean that it's going to be, Quinnipiac College too.
Well, it could be the Delahanty Institute, where they have rooms around.
Yeah.
All right, so look, we'll deal with that. That's fine. Clinics, medical and dental are okay. Offices, business and professional are okay. Offices, businesses, and professionals. So that's not limiting it to doctors and dentists. That's saying...
The CPA.
Well, no, if you say offices, business, and professional, then potentially you could have an office building. But I guess we already had an office building on that lot, so who cares?
Right, but it could potentially be an office building, but it's not going to exceed the 40-foot height limit. It's not going to be 6 stories or 5 stories. So
like condominium offices, that's what it would be.
Office condominiums, yeah. All right. Financial institutions. The Bank of Guilford. We're striking retail stores, restaurants, number 10 clinic, medical and dental, because it's mentioned previously. Personal service is gone, and thank goodness for that. Research laboratories.
Well, those are interesting.
Is Quest Diagnostics a research laboratory?
No, it's a blood draw.
Research laboratory, they have these, I heard of a problem in Bramford, research laboratories and testing on animals, they use a lot of water and stuff, I guess, at these research laboratories.
So we don't really need this, do we? Like if we start, you're okay?
Yeah, take it out.
I
would agree with taking that research.
Franco?
I was just going through the personal service stuff. no nail salons, no hairdressers. I think that's gonna make a big difference. No barber shops.
Thank you.
No laser treatment.
That's great.
No laser hair removal.
Well, I was gonna go do some laser work.
Rogaine work.
Yeah, Rogaine. Thank you. I'm going bald in case you can't see it from the camera. They're kicking me right now. So research laboratories, you're okay with taking that out?
Well, my only comment on that, and I am okay with taking it out, because I do think it's out of the grouping of things, it probably has the most impact on the community.
Yeah.
It also probably has easiest for a business person to find a location as well. We're worried about them renting out some units. I think laboratories are something that pop up all over the place all the time. Yeah, I do. You get a little grant from Yale and you open up a little laboratory for 6 months, 8 months, and then you close it down when your grant's gone.
So,
I'm okay taking it out, I'm just making a comment.
All right, good. Thank you. Buildings, uses, and facilities of the town. Joe's going to open up an office there. Skilled nursing facilities, hospitals, urgent medical care facilities. Are we okay with that?
You know what? I think I'm okay with it because I don't know anybody in their right mind would want to put one in there
with these restrictions.
With not only that, with Yale already there and a bunch of doctors around there, I don't know.
All right, so
that's a win. That's a lose-lose situation for anybody trying to do that.
Okay.
I would leave it.
Okay. Places of worship, we're not going to touch. Artists, studio, galleries, and other establishments where arts and crafts and merchandise is created, displayed, and sold. Who cares? Museums, that's fine. Farms.
Can't touch farms.
Can't touch. This is an agricultural community, as you know. Okay, so the wording of this next paragraph is cool with you?
Yep. Got side setbacks and all that stuff that's already in there.
Got it. Eight. Area, location, and bulk standards. So 160,000 square feet is 4 acres. Lot shape is now 100, not 150. Lot frontage is 100, fine. Setbacks were fine. We're limited to 4 per acre.
Right.
And it says that somewhere, doesn't it?
It was in the amendment, or it doesn't say it in there. It's in my motion because of what I previously
said. Yeah, from 6 to 4.
Record. Right, so 4 per acre.
Yes.
Okay. This is all good. And so the change we made is the maximum building height is 40 feet.
And the other change we made was research laboratory.
What? Not yet. Because there's still a motion on the table.
Yes, there's a motion on the table.
Could I ask what is maximum landscaped area, 50% of the pervious surface of the lot may be landscaped. Well, what do you do with the rest of the lot?
Grass.
Well, grass is landscaping.
It could be
pervious. Non-pervious.
So remember that the size of this lot, a lot of it is wetlands.
Yeah.
So you know, you're not going to do anything with that. Yeah.
All right. All in agreement?
Yeah.
All right. So any other things?
You changed the maximum building height to 40 there, right?
Yeah. Richard, any last minute things? Josh?
Did you want me to amend my motion on the research laboratories? We'll continue to talk.
Yeah, we'll. Tom likes his research laboratories.
No, I can take it out.
Yeah, I'm okay with if you want to amend it.
Let's take it out. Let's take it out. We can always put it back in.
Wait, what's going on?
Taking out the research.
Do you want to take the labs out?
I don't really.
Just amend it and do it so we can.
He's in control.
Fine. I'd like to amend my motion to remove research laboratories.
Did you second?
I didn't second.
Tom.
I'll second.
Okay.
All right. Any other last minute changes? Here it comes. Are you ready? All those in favor?
I'm in favor, but you know, just, you know, we're talking about the density in here, and this says for mixed use development, any site larger than 20 acres, not more than 50 of a lot size area shall be used for any single use except where the single use is residential. That's already in here. I just noticed that.
It's larger than 20 acres. So larger than 20 acres. So this isn't. Is this larger?
16.
Yes. This
so if you wanted to put one of something on it, it can only use half of the property. Is it more than? 16. Is this property more than 20 acres?
16 acres. 16.
So it's under that. So
this is for other areas as it's applied.
Yeah. All right.
All right. So we're ready to vote. We're good.
Yeah,
we're in. All right. 5 minutes and we have to change the tape. Let's see if we can do something.
Finish up the business.
Let's wrap it up really quickly.
Will we approve the bills?
We got some, a couple other things.
400.
We got the mandatory.
400. What could we spend $400 on?
We got some mandatory.
Keep wanting that.
Yeah.
If I can find it.
Right here, I got it.
You want me to read it?
This is Brian spending this $400.
Brian McGlone. Want me to read the mandatory referral?
Yes.
In accordance with the Connecticut General Statutes, Chapter 126, Section 8-24, the Guilford Planning Zoning Commission has reviewed and reports favorably on a mandatory referral for the acquisition of two parcels from George Goss III, Dirk W. Goss, Edwin Leader Goss, and Helen Farrell Goss, located off Leatherman Road, an inclusive portion of Old Bear House Road, Bear House Hill Road, as depicted on map 4850 of Bear House Hill Estates subdivision, which was required as part of the subdivision approval.
I'll second it. It has to be seconded.
There's a letter behind here.
You put that in the form of a motion, I'm sure, and address that. What's the letter say?
This is to Rich Meyer from Joe Mazza for selectmen. Dear Rich, in accordance with the Connecticut General Statutes 8-24, I am forwarding the following request for your June 17th meeting. Mandatory referral. I just read everything else in there. Yep. Thank you for your comment.
That's good that you're doing that. Thanks, Joe. All right, so we have he put it in the form of a motion, he made a second, all those in favor, there you go, set. We have a couple more minutes, Shannon? We do.
Here's the, did we actually vote on the expense of $414?
No, we didn't. I was trying to let that slide because it's killing me.
I move we pay the bill.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye. I think Reggie has something to say.
I do. I have a violator who is not complying. And this person has been violating since June 13th of 2014. And it's time that he stops. He built two sheds, too close to the road and too close to a side yard setback. And I've been in contact with him. He said he was going to move the sheds. Then he was going to come in and get an extension. I talked to him July 14th, July of 2014, July 30th of 2014, August 26th of 2014, September 26th of 2014, right. September 29th of 2014, September 15th of 2014, January 5th this year, and he called and said he was leaving for vacation. And he can move the sheds back, but be close to his neighbor's fence line, and he hasn't done anything.
So
I would like to find him.
You don't have to ask us anymore, do you?
Well, no, this is not for science. This is for
science, it's for everything.
We gave you the
You have permission for everything to follow out.
Then they can appeal to us.
Find that will.
Do what you got to do. Okay.
All right.
Good.
Levy.
All right.
Thank
so those,
you.
Thank you. And we're sorry you have to keep on dealing with these same things. I mean, that's been going on for a year. All right.
Approval of minutes.
Yeah, there's something missing. We're not going to deal with it in 2 minutes either because I can't talk that quickly. We received a letter from Mr. Mazza in regards to something that's out of our control. I'd just like to. I don't know that I can. I'll talk really quickly. So we had a letter of complaint from a citizen that addressed to me as chair of planning and zoning, and it's not a planning and zoning issue. It has to do with the coffee trucks, food trucks that are parking around the green. The board of selectmen are the ones who will make this decision. It is entirely up to them to craft some sort of limitations on it or not. Currently, we have the minimal limitations placed by the permitting process from the police, but we have seen them around the green, and Mr. Mazza has written me a letter that they're going to deal with that, so he's going to deal with that, hopefully soon. So we had a chance to review the minutes. Can I get a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
And they're substantially correct. Are you seconding it? You're butting.
No, someone else did. I'm just saying yes.
No, I didn't say.
I'll second it.
There we go. We got a second. All those in favor? Aye. Any other business before the commission?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
All those in favor? Aye. Good night, everybody.